Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Twitch Upon a Star, The Bewitched Life and Career of Elizabeth Montgomery, by Herbie J. Pilato. Narrated by Herbie J. Pilato and Michael Butler Murray. Win, lose, or draw, I'm going to keep on being Elizabeth Montgomery. Elizabeth Montgomery, 1965. Lizzie didn't want to walk around for the rest of her life being Samantha. Ronnie Cox, friend and co-star of Elizabeth Montgomery's. I ain't never met another woman I wanted to be like. Belle Starr, as played by Elizabeth Montgomery in the 1980 TV movie of the same name. Preface. In 1979, Elizabeth Montgomery appeared in the NBC TV movie Jennifer, A Woman's Story, in which she played Jennifer Prince, the widow of a wealthy shipbuilding executive. In this backdoor pilot for a new series that Montgomery chose not to pursue, Jennifer battled the highbrow board members of her late husband's company that she struggled to control. On Bewitched, which originally aired on ABC from 1964 to 1972, Elizabeth portrayed the beloved nose-wriggling house witch, Samantha Stevens. In an episode from 1969, The Battle of Burning Oak, Samantha and her feisty mother, Endora, Agnes Moorhead, forged one of their rare but sturdy alliances and set out to discredit the braggart members of a private mortal club. With this and every segment of Bewitched, Elizabeth played Samantha not so much as a witch with a twitch, but as a woman who just so happens to be a witch, who just so happens to twitch. How she machinated the magic was secondary to the sorcery itself. The supernatural acts were not nearly as pertinent as the distinguishing and ironic essence of Samantha, her humanity. In like manner, Elizabeth eagerly utilized her benevolence with an extraordinary life and career, relinquishing an arrogance that could have easily evolved by way of her prestigious upbringing. As the liberal daughter of film and television legend Robert Montgomery, a staunch Republican, and Broadway actress Elizabeth Allen, an elegant Southern belle, she became disillusioned with the loftiness of Hollywood. She retained an unaffected demeanor on the set of any one of her nearly 500 individual television and film performances, or when approached on the street by some random fan. In either scenario, she relished the simple treasures of life, just as Samantha embraced the everyday mortal way. Elizabeth, however, was not immortal in real life. Her light was dimmed too soon. On May 18th, 1995, she died a victim of colon cancer, only 2 months after completing production of Deadline for Murder, her second CBS TV movie as true life Miami crime reporter, Edna Buchanan. Her first, The Corpse Had a Familiar Face, aired in 1994. The shining star, the iconic actress, the outspoken political activist, the kind and loving mother to three children, with Bewitched producer-director William Asher, William Jr., Robert, and Rebecca, and the very private and all-too-human woman, was gone. It was devastating news for those within her intimate circle, and to the millions of fans who continued to worship her from afar. More than 15 years after her painful demise, countless Facebook pages are adorned with her name. Over 800,000 readers of TV Guide once voted her more popular than Barbara Eden, the star of classic TV's other supernatural blonde-led sitcom, I Dream of Jeannie, a blatant replica of Bewitched that infuriated Elizabeth, and her TV movies remain classics. In 1974, she received an Emmy nomination for A Case of Rape, which originally aired on NBC, a decade before the network aired the similarly themed film, The Burning Bed, starring Farrah Fawcett. Case became the first issue-oriented TV movie of its time, helped to change human rights and legislation for rape victims, and registered itself as one of the highest-rated TV movies in history. In 1975, Elizabeth received another Emmy nomination for ABC's The Legend of Lizzie Borden, a namesake and alleged distant sixth cousin that she took a particular delight in portraying, which will soon be remade for the big screen. Her feature films remain revered as well. 1955's The Court Martial of Billy Mitchell, 1963's Who's Been Sleeping in My Bed, in which she co-starred with Dean Martin and good friend Carol Burnett, and Johnny Cool, also released in 1963, directed by William Asher, who died in Palm Desert, California on July 16, 2012 at age 90 due to complications from Alzheimer's disease, whom she met and fell in love with on the set. Approximately 1 year later, on September 17, 1964, Bewitched debuted and was party to the escapist entertainment that America sorely needed amidst the upheaval of the era. Elizabeth, like her contemporary, actress Jane Fonda, to whom she was frequently compared in appearance and talent, protested the country's involvement with Vietnam. Her father was none too pleased with his daughter's political view. Such opposition was an earmark for their entire relationship until the day he died in 1981, succumbing to cancer, like Elizabeth. A few years later, she delivered the chilling narration for two controversial feature film documentaries. Cover Up, 1988, which detailed the murky circumstances surrounding the Iran-Contra affair, and The Panama Deception, 1992, about the American invasion of Panama, which won the Oscar that year for Best Feature-Length Documentary. Into this mix, she, along with Elizabeth Taylor, another legendary actress and good friend, became one of the first courageous few to lend support in the mid-1980s to those suffering from AIDS, then a widespread and misunderstood disease affecting mostly homosexual men. Subsequently, among her multitude of enthusiasts are those within the gay community. Her appeal and notoriety with this portion of the population is unparalleled, thanks in part to her humanitarian efforts for research into AIDS, no longer just a gay disease. In 1992, she sealed that acclaim when she served as co-grand marshal for the Los Angeles Gay Pride Parade with former Bewitched star Dick Sargent, who had recently exited the closet. Through it all, the central message of Bewitched, as she suggested, believed, and trumpeted, was prejudice. Samantha was a sorceress, isolated in a mortal world, a witch out of water, a repressed housewife instructed by an overbearing human husband, Darren, played by Dick York, later replaced by Sargent, to never reveal her true identity. Despite what critics perceived as confinement, Samantha was a free spirit, an independent soul. It was her choice to live the mortal life, and Elizabeth sought to convey the significance of that directive. Liberated women embraced her contributions with Bewitched and beyond, and Samantha became the first independent and powerful woman of the television age. She reflected the progress womanhood had made in the eyes of the public at large. This, on the heels of Betty Friedan's blockbuster book, The Feminine Mystique, which, when released in 1963, 1 year before Bewitched debuted, documented more than any other single factor the launch of women's lib. Like many raised in the glare of Hollywood, Elizabeth lived a life that was sprinkled with stardust and littered with trauma. She had loving but disparate relationships, including a core-shaping and life-shifting association with her father, who objected to her liberal views and her initial decision to become an actress. She loved life, and life loved her back, although not always as evenly, particularly in the form of marriages to first husband New York blueblood, Fred Kamen, and her second husband, the troubled and alcoholic actor Gig Young. Her third and fourth husbands, William Asher and actor Robert Foxworth, best known as Chase Gioberti on CBS TV's Falcon Crest, were equal lights in her life. But like all true love affairs, even these relationships proved uneven. 8 years after her divorce from Asher, she appeared in the 1982 TV miniseries The Rules of Marriage, which co-starred Elliot Gould. They played Joan and Michael Hagen, a successful suburban couple who found new partners after separating on their 15th wedding anniversary. Like much of Elizabeth's work, marriage broke the rules when its characters broke the fourth wall and periodically talked to the camera, documentary style, as on contemporary shows The Office and Modern Family. But The Rules of Marriage was not a comedy, and no one was laughing on stage or off. Joan Hagen was a seemingly happy, affluent wife, and so was Elizabeth when wedded to Asher during the original reign of Bewitched. Marriage showcased the disintegration of a seemingly perfect marriage, as both husband and wife became involved in a series of affairs. Asher strayed from Elizabeth throughout their marriage and into the final years of Bewitched, which ultimately led to her 2-year affair with Bewitched producer-director Richard Michaels, and to their subsequent divorce and business dissolve. Bewitched was canceled in 1972, and the Asher marriage ended in 1974, around the time she met and fell in love with Foxworth on the set of her TV movie, Mrs. Sundance. She didn't leave Asher for Foxworth. She fell in love with Foxworth after her marriage ended. Foxworth was to have played Michael Hagen in The Rules of Marriage, but when cast as Chase on Crest, he was replaced by Gould, formerly married to Barbara Streisand, another high-powered, strong-willed, independent female force in the entertainment industry. Elizabeth now sought work diametrically opposed to Bewitched, but periodically opted to play characters that represented her role in real life. She gave 100% to each character she portrayed, but savored parts that were leaps and bounds from Samantha. Unsuppressed ambitions may have taxed at least her first marriage to Fred Kamen, but beyond that, her career took a backseat to family. There was no stopping her always forthright but elegant manner. While the parallels between her and Twitch Witch Samantha, her most famous role, for which she was Emmy-nominated 5 times, were undeniable. Elizabeth was born to 2 actors, not of the ordinary, screen idol Robert Montgomery and Broadway thespian Elizabeth Allen. Samantha was born to 2 extraordinary beings, Endora and Maurice, played by acting legends Agnes Moorehead and Maurice Evans. Elizabeth was raised in privilege with mansions, movie stars like Betty Davis and James Cagney as good friends, the best schools to attend, including Harvard Westlake School in Los Angeles and the Spence School for Girls in New York, and traveled the world. Samantha was raised in opulence, had the best teachers the witch world had to offer, and enjoyed otherworldly travels. Elizabeth shunned the arrogance of her elitist background and retained an approachable demeanor. Samantha rejected the arrogance of her supernatural heritage and remained down to earth. Elizabeth's first upper-crust New York husband, Kamen, was thrown out of the social register because he married an actress, a profession frowned upon by his aristocratic family. Samantha's clan believed her mortal husband, Darren, disgraced their aristocratic family heritage. And just as Kamen wanted Elizabeth to give up her craft of acting, Darren wanted Samantha to give up witchcraft. Elizabeth made frequent attempts to stop acting, but failed. Her talent was her destiny. Despite Samantha's earnest attempts to embrace the mortal life, she never quite stopped using her powers to assist Darren and friends. Her magic was her birthright. Elizabeth deeply loved each of her 4 husbands. Samantha deeply loved her 2 Darrens. Elizabeth embraced her theatrical gifts and challenging marriages. Samantha embraced her special powers and mixed marriage. Elizabeth raised her family in the traditional manner. Samantha raised her children in, again, the everyday mortal way. Elizabeth played childhood games with her look-alike cousin, Amanda, Panda, Cushman. Samantha's adult life was challenged by her fun-loving look-alike cousin, Serena, played by Elizabeth, but billed as Pandora Sparks. Elizabeth became a beloved celebrity worldwide and queen of the TV movies. Samantha was elected Queen of the Witches. Elizabeth was a political activist who defended her rights and the rights of others, from Vietnam to the Reagan era and beyond. Samantha fought City Hall in the mortal world, defended her rights to the Witches' Council, and decried arrogance in both realms. Elizabeth represented the grassroots movement of the day, women's liberation. Samantha defended her personal witch's honor. Elizabeth cherished her family and home life beyond Hollywood, and ultimately accepted her immortal legacy as Samantha. Samantha treasured her family and human life, and ultimately accepted her mortal existence. This book is about Elizabeth's mortal existence. From the day she was born, she had a nervous facial tic that was destined to inspire Samantha's magical mugging twitch. It was a mere speck in a vast list of traits and characteristics, characters, and performances that appealed to a mass group of people. That's also what this book is about, and everything else in between.
Introduction. Elizabeth Montgomery welcomed me into her hushed world. I was enamored with the rise, demise, and rebirth of Bewitched, and she was intrigued. She marveled in my appreciation of not only her most famous show, but her varied accomplishments, talents, and charitable ways, like Nick at Night. Initially reticent, then unrestrained, she, for the first time in 20 years, offered in-depth conversations about her life and career. She explained during the first of what would become four interviews in the spring and summer of 1989. "It's a strange thing. I loathe to chat away about me. I've never liked it. I always hate interviews. I just want to act and do the best job I can. Hopefully, people will appreciate it. That's what my job is. It isn't sitting down and talking about me. If I were a gardener," which she fancied herself as around her home in Beverly Hills, "I would be out there trying to make gardens as pretty as I could, and not expect people to come up to me and ask a lot of questions. What it boils down to is this: it's always easier for me to talk about other things than it is to talk about me." She described our conversations as cathartic. She spoke about her famous father, film and TV idol Robert Montgomery, her childhood, years of education, early motion pictures, stage, and television appearances. She addressed what it means to be an actress, her friendships with President John F. Kennedy, assassinated on November 22, 1963, the day rehearsals began for Bewitched, Carol Burnett, and her Bewitched co-stars, including Agnes Moorehead and Paul Lynde, her TV movies and feature films, and of course, Bewitched itself. She discussed all she did and didn't understand about herself and her massive following, all she gave, all she became, all she hoped to be, all she was: a wife, a mother, a friend, a TV legend, a pop culture icon, a courageously bold endorser of human rights. My Bewitched books concentrated on her most renowned performance, but a more expansive, magical story was yet to be told. Twitch Upon a Star, The Bewitched Life and Career of Elizabeth Montgomery, tells that story. The unpublished memories she shared with me in 1989 are now interspersed with her commentary from other interviews before and after we met. Only following our chats did she allow for lengthier conversations with regard to Bewitched after she ended the show in 1972. She then seemed more comfortable discussing her career, specifically her days on Bewitched, from which she had long kept safe distance. She later gave interviews to One-on-One with John Tesh, The Dennis Miller Show, CBS This Morning, and The Advocate magazine, as well as to acclaimed film historian, preservationist, and author Ronald Haver, who for 20 years, he died in 1993, served as the curator and director for the Los Angeles County Museum of Art's Film Center. The latter interview transpired for a commentary track accompanying the 15th anniversary documentary 1991 laser disc release of Here Comes Mr. Jordan, the 1941 film classic starring her father, Robert Montgomery. Elizabeth and I also talked about her dad, as well as her mother, former Broadway actress Elizabeth Allen, and her maternal grandmother, Rebecca Allen, all of whom played substantial roles in the development of her life and work, a career that she sometimes felt was overshadowed by Bewitched. Yet she had little choice but to address her immortal link to Samantha. By the time we met in 1989, 25 years after Bewitched's debut, she and the show's popularity reigned steady, expanded by way of nostalgic-oriented networks like Nick at Night, TBS, and WGN. The series flooded the airwaves. She was finding a new audience, and original and novice fans were falling in love with her all over again. When I asked if she understood just how happy she makes viewers, how classic and contemporary fans adore her just as much, if not more, as when the show premiered in 1964, she replied, "Well, I do now. I mean, you've pointed it out to me, certainly. I know they like the show and everything, but it's never been anything that's kind of been bounced in my face as much as it has with your focus on it. And I tell you something, if only one person feels as you do, then that's fine with me. Something was accomplished because your dedication to this has been absolutely extraordinary. It's the work that is to me its kind of own reward. I know that sounds terribly Pollyanna, but I don't care because that's true for me. And it's the same with you, to put that much energy into what you have done and for us to be sitting here is very good for both of us. It's good for you on every level that you have explained to me, and it's fun for me to sit down and talk about it with somebody who enjoys it that much because I've done so much since Bewitched. While doing something you're so concentrated on it, you don't get a chance to sit back and say, wasn't that or isn't that fun? I'd like to think that the stuff that I've done since has meant something to somebody on various different levels, because I've tried to be real diverse in the work that I've done since I left Bewitched." Her post-1989 interviews with others proved insightful from a personal standpoint. One in particular stands out from the pack. In 1990, veteran television journalist Ann Hodges, mother to a dear friend, talked with Elizabeth for the Houston Chronicle about her CBS Hallmark Hall of Fame TV film Face to Face. After the interview, Anne put down her pen and paper and said, "I just have to tell you, my daughter is very good friends with one of your biggest fans." Before Anne had a chance to finish her sentence, Elizabeth blurted out the name, "Herbie." There are countless individuals and fan-based groups who assuredly know the more minute trivia related to Elizabeth's entire body of work. But that she would think of me amidst a random reference remains a cherished memory and not insignificant praise. I was honored to hear of that interchange, which I will forever humbly embrace. I can do nothing less. Elizabeth was one of the kindest people I ever met and one of the least arrogant in or outside of Hollywood. I admired her lack of pretension and strive to meet that standard every day. That said, she was also one of the most complicated individuals on the planet, a conundrum that makes her story so compelling, and one in turn that I felt driven, dare I say, bewitched, to explore and share within these chapters. This book is also filled with collected reflections from her family members and friends and co-workers from her TV movies, feature films, TV guest star appearances, and other performances, and of course, Bewitched. Thoughts from interviews that she and others granted to me appear alongside selected commentary previously published in studio bios, press releases, newspaper and magazine articles, books, TV talk shows, and news programs, and online sources. There are new memories from my exclusive interviews with her friend and fellow actress Sally Kemp, whom Elizabeth met while attending the New York Academy of Dramatic Arts and who offers some of the most profound insight into Elizabeth's young life. Florence the Brady Bunch Henderson, also from the Academy. Her TV movie co-stars and friends, including David Nell, who played her son on Bell Star, Ronnie Cox, from A Case of Rape and With Murder in Mind, the Oscar-winning actor Cliff Robertson, who died only 2 weeks after granting his interview, Bewitched guest star Eric Scott, who would later be cast in The Waltons, Peter Ackerman, son of Bewitched executive producer Harry Ackerman, Bewitched writer Doug Tibbles, Emmy-winning actor and Elizabeth's fellow political advocate Ed Asner, The Mary Tyler Moore Show, actress, comedian, women and children's advocate, and political blogger Lydia Cornell from Too Close for Comfort, among many others. Also included are never-before-published commentary from my original Bewitched interviews in 1988 and 1989 with Harry Ackerman, William Asher, Dick York, and Dick Sargent, the two Darrens, David Larry Tate White, and others associated with the series, including Bewitched director Richard Michaels, who, in 2006, went on Entertainment Tonight and admitted to his affair with Elizabeth. It was an affair that contributed to the downfall of the show and Elizabeth's marriage to Asher, as well as Michael's nuptials to Christina Hansen. When I interviewed Michaels in 1988, I was not aware of his liaison with Elizabeth, but you'd think I'd have a clue. We met in Santa Monica for lunch at the Crest, then a new but very regular eatery along the lines of Perkins or Denny's, if maybe just slightly upscale. Michaels was cordial, informative, intelligent, and his memories of Bewitched and all that it entailed were astounding. But as we finished our interview, he started to tear up. "When you talk with Elizabeth," he instructed me, "you be sure to tell her that I said there will never be anyone else like her in the world. Never." Originally taken aback by that statement, especially when he made me vow to relay it, I ultimately agreed, and upon meeting Elizabeth, kept my promise. After hearing Michael's message, she looked at me and said, "That's very sweet." And that was that. With hindsight being 20/20, it appeared that Michaels was still in love with Elizabeth. Who wouldn't be? Another unexpected event occurred when, upon my second interview with Elizabeth, she surprised me by having invited Bewitched actor David White to join us. He and Elizabeth had not seen one another since the series ended in 1972. At the time, that was approximately 18 years. Portions of their individual and interlocking commentary from that day, all never before published, now appear in this book. Who would have thought that Elizabeth and David, along with so many other Bewitched luminaries, Dick York, Dick Sargent, Harry Ackerman, Alice Ghostly, who portrayed Samantha's bumbling witch maid Esmeralda, etc., would be gone only a few years later. White died in 1991, York in 1993, Sargent in 1994, and Elizabeth in 1995, the latter three of which while only in their 60s. Unfortunately, I was unable to attend Elizabeth's memorial service at the Cannon Theater in Beverly Hills on June 18, 1995. I was also unable to attend a ceremony in her name when finally, if posthumously, she received her designated star on the Hollywood Walk of Fame January 4, 2008. Fortunately, my good friend and radio journalist Joan Devlin managed to at least attend the star ceremony and shared with me what transpired at that event. In addition to what was reported in the press and from further research, I learned that it was an illustrious event. Unfortunately, Sally Kemp, Lizzie's best friend from their youth, was also unable to be present at the star ceremony at which the name Elizabeth Montgomery was so elegantly chiseled in glittering stone on that famous walkway. While pleased that her friend was immortalized in exactly that manner, Sally was puzzled as to why her friend would later answer to anything but her formal birth name. "It's strange for me to hear Elizabeth referred to as Lizzie," Kemp told me in 2012. "Never while I knew her was she called that. She didn't like Liz either, only Elizabeth. Lizzie must have been born after she and Gig Young decamped to L.A. I just wonder where it came from." At the Walk of Fame ceremony, The answer was provided by Liz Sheridan, best known as Helen Seinfeld, Jerry's mother on NBC's iconic 1990s non-sitcom Seinfeld. Sheridan is also known as Miss Akmonik, a Mrs. Kravitz-type neighbor on NBC's 1980s alien com Elf, which, like Bewitched, was an otherworldly, fish-out-of-water sitcom. Samantha was a witch in a mortal world. Elf was an alien in a human world. Best friends in their later years, Sheridan was introduced to Elizabeth through writer William Blast, who in 1974 penned The Legend of Lizzie Borden. From what I learned, Sheridan explained at the ceremony, Elizabeth wanted to be called Lizzie from the moment she played Borden. It was a nice play on a name, especially when Sheridan was around, because Sheridan's younger sister could never quite pronounce the name Elizabeth, the formal first name she and Lizzie shared. According to what Sheridan explained, it also came out Dizzybeth. In effect, Sheridan became Dizzy and Montgomery became Lizzie, and there they were, Lizzie and Dizzy. So however serious Elizabeth was about her life and career, she knew when not to take herself seriously. She imbued a playful spirit towards Borden that stemmed from her childhood. I used to get teased all the time about the childhood rhyme, Lizzie Borden took an axe, etc., she said in 1989. Robert Foxworth and I were apparently then slated to reap the brunt of that teasing, so to speak, as when Elizabeth revealed to me a memory she had of the two vacationing at her summer home shortly after the Lizzie Borden movie aired. At one point during the getaway, it was raining, and he was kneeling in front of the fireplace attempting to ignite a flame. And I had an axe in my hand, she remembered, because we had just chopped some wood. Foxworth then turned toward her, pointed to the axe, and made a request. Would you please put that thing down? The axe was making him nervous, and she knew it. But with a devilish smile belying what she recognized as the truth, Elizabeth asked ever so innocently, What? He reiterated, Would you please put that thing down? She finally complied, and once they cozied up to the fire, he made an admission. I have to tell you, that axe really gives me the creeps. She told me this story in 1989 at her Beverly Hills home while holding the prop axe from the Borden film and standing next to another fireplace, so I knew exactly how he felt. You see, she said with utter delight, as I sat there squirming, This is the actual axe. It used to have hairs on it, and I keep telling people not to dust it, but they do, and they've taken some of the blood off it. It's not very sharp, but it would do the job. She had a wicked sense of humor, a measure of which I had already experienced. In the early part of 1989, and upon her permission, Bill Asher had given me her phone number. I called her and did not hear back from her until 4 months later, or at least that's how long it seemed. This occurred about 10 years before cell and smartphones hit the mainstream market. At best, I stayed close to my old-fangled answering machine, but I still missed her call on several occasions, although she later confessed to hanging up many times without leaving a message. Why? She didn't know how to respond to the Bewitched theme and twitching sound effects from the show's opening credits that I had taken great pains to strategically record on my machine, again, in a pre-high-tech phone apps ringtone era. We finally did connect while I was living in Santa Monica and had one day temporarily stepped away from the phone to place a load of towels in the wash. I later noticed the flashing message light on my machine. Pressed play and heard, Hi, it's Lizzie Montgomery. I keep missing you. You keep missing me. This is crazy. Like Sally Kemp, not only was I surprised to hear the nickname Lizzie being voiced by the actress herself, but I was somewhat frazzled in general that Elizabeth Montgomery had just telephoned to my house and left a message on my machine. In any event, I collected my thoughts, waited a few moments, and then called her back. She picked up the phone, we exchanged hellos, and I apologized for missing her call. I was doing my laundry, I said, as if talking with an old friend, which, in a way, I was. I had been watching Bewitched nearly my entire life and easily recognized Lizzie's voice and mannerisms. Upon hearing of such a humble task, she responded with her trademark giggle and said, "And so you should." It was so typically Elizabeth to put me or anyone else at ease. Our conversations continued, and she was nothing less than charming and disarming with each subsequent visit, either by phone or in person. At our first meeting, we were both nervous. I tripped over her coffee table, and she carefully weighed her words. During our second meeting, we considered the signatory roles she played in my life, and she was slightly more relaxed and free with her phrasing. At one point, we took our conversation from her living room to the kitchen so she could feed her dog, Zuleika. A small countertop TV was blaring in the background, set on a PBS cooking show. I picked up our conversation. "You know, whatever critic has reviewed you in the past," "I know," she interrupted, "because forget it. You're worse than my father, right?" I smiled, but at the same time, did not fully grasp the assumption. Only later did I comprehend what she meant. In researching this book, I realized just how muddled her relationship was with her father. As individuals, they were each complicated. In combination, they were confounding. But whenever she spoke of him in our conversations or with others, there was an underlined air of respect. He and his wife, actress Elizabeth Allen, had raised her well in tandem with Allen's mother, Lizzie's beloved grandmother, Rebecca Becca Allen. Becca also had a positive influence on Elizabeth's brother, Robert Skip Montgomery Jr., whom I had the privilege of speaking with shortly after she passed away in 1995. A few years later, I was saddened to learn of Skip's own passing in 2000. When Bill Asher told me, I wanted to call Skip's wife Melanie, but never did. I regret that, and not speaking with Skip more often. But I'll never forget our first conversation. He was so cordial and down to earth, just like Elizabeth. As much as they were blessed in life, neither possessed an ounce of arrogance. He called to inquire what I wanted to do with the crystal unicorn I had given to Elizabeth upon our first meeting. Samantha liked the unicorns, and so did Elizabeth, and she loved presents and appreciated gifts, even in the most token form. Yet the crystal unicorn was no small token. At the time, I had little extra cash to spend on so extravagant a gift. Elizabeth, of course, was worth it, but she was stunned when she saw it. She turned toward me, gave me a big hug, and said in that lyrical voice of hers, "Oh my, you know, don't you? You know." Skip had the same kind of upbeat, chipper, affable voice. "Hey, Herbie," he said that day when I picked up the phone. "How you doing? This is Skip Montgomery. Listen, I have the unicorn that you gave Elizabeth. Do you want it back?" "No, no, no," I replied. "You keep it. I wanted her to have it, and I want you to keep it in her memory." We talked a little more, exchanged addresses, and the following December, I received a Christmas card from him and Melanie, a special memento that I cherish to this day more than I could have ever treasured the return of that unicorn. The entire Montgomery family has always been kind to me, including Elizabeth's children, as well as Robert Foxworth, who I had profiled for Sci-Fi Entertainment magazine in 1996, and certainly to Bill Asher. One day, in between interviews with Elizabeth, she telephoned me out of the blue just to see how I was. That morning, I was upset. The strings were broken on the guitar my father had purchased for me when I was a young boy. I was desperate to fix them, not because I played the guitar so well, which I never properly learned to do, but because the instrument held sentimental value, like that Christmas card from Skipwood years later. For some reason, I explained all of this to Elizabeth, and to my surprise, she in turn told me that Billy Asher Jr. would fix my weeping guitar. "Why don't you bring it to my son?" she said. "Huh? What do you mean?" "That's what he does. He owns a music shop in Santa Monica." "You're kidding. I live in Santa Monica," I said. Where? On 17th Street and Santa Monica Boulevard, I replied. I'm going to make this real simple for you, she said. His shop is at 17th and Wilshire Boulevard. That's just up the street. Then you better get going. We said goodbye, I hung up, packed my guitar, and was out the door. By the time I reached Wilshire, Lizzie had already called Billy to tell him I was on my way. When I arrived at his shop, he was standing at the counter. I shook his hand, explained about the guitar, and a few days later, it was like new again. We chatted about his mom, and I immediately noticed he had inherited her down-to-earth demeanor. When I told him so, he shared a few stories of what it was like growing up, not only as her son, but as the son of the legendary director, Bill Asher. He recalled a time in 1968, when he was just 8 years old, and a certain bewitching screen transfer proved somewhat confusing for him. One Thursday night, at around 8 o'clock, he was at home watching his mom on TV. It just so happened that Thursday night was the one day a week when the Bewitched cast and crew worked later than usual. Elizabeth did not usually arrive home until about 8:15 or 8:30 p.m. But this one night, she walked in the Asher's front door just as Samantha popped out on Bewitched. 8-year-old Billy was startled. "Geez, Mommy," he said, "you really are a witch." Elizabeth offered a careful explanation. "No, honey, I just play one on TV." Another time when Billy was a teenager, circa 1977, he was again in the Asher living room, but this time with a friend who was unaware of his heritage. At one point, Elizabeth walked in the room to get a magazine off the coffee table. His friend screamed, "Oh my gosh, it's Elizabeth Montgomery!" "Nah," Billy said, ever carefree, "that's just my mom." Not one to boast about position or social status, Billy, along with his brother Robert, named for Elizabeth's father, and daughter Rebecca, named for her grandmother Becca, always chose to walk with dignity and integrity, as they do to this day. Rebecca has always been cordial in the few phone conversations we've shared, displaying her mother's sense of humor each time. When I first talked with her, it took her a few weeks to call me back, just as it had been with Elizabeth. When I mentioned this to Rebecca, she laughed and said, "It must be genetic." Genes had everything to do with it, especially when it came to Lizzie's grandmother, Becca, whom she brought up at the close of our third interview in 1989, following my confession. "You know who I really am, don't you?" I posed, if somewhat cryptically. "No," she said, followed by a cautious pause. "Who?" "I'm your guardian angel," I said. Surprised and relieved, she smiled sweetly and said, "The last person who referred to themselves that way was my grandmother, Becca. And if it's true that you are indeed my guardian angel sent to replace her, well, then you better do one hell of a good job." More than 30 years after that exchange, I make an earnest attempt to do just that with this book, which could be described as part biography, part media history guide, part psychology book, part mystic primer, part political dossier, all trustingly compelling. But Lizzie placed high expectations on biographies, in particular, referring here to one-page actor profiles that publicists for the studios and networks put together to promote the TV show or film in which a given actor is currently starring. I've always found them very self-conscious, and they've always bothered me. I've never found one that somebody's written that I've liked. I always think they are dry and stupid and don't really mean much to anybody. Hopefully, Twitch Upon a Star, The Bewitched Life and Career of Elizabeth Montgomery, will mean something to someone, be it a member of Elizabeth's family, a friend, a fan, because it's a real story, a human story, an honest story. Because sincerity was one of the many virtues which Elizabeth held dear. It's a profile in humility and generosity, because such traits shaped who she was, strived to be, and became, and who she remains in the hearts and minds of millions. It's a portrait painted with memories of her playful spirit, intelligent mind, and expansive resume. It's the sum of her intricacies and complexities. I agonize over whether or not to present particular passages in this book. Some may be disturbing to hear. They certainly prove challenging for me to report. I'd type in specific paragraphs and then delete them. I'd paste them back in and then cut them out again. Finally, I decided to buckle down and include them because it was time to address the elephant in the room. The previous books were fan letters about a fantasy TV show, written as though seen through rose-colored glasses. With this book, I had a job to do. This time, it's not a fairy tale, but a true love story. And all true love stories are earmarked with happy and sad elements. As a human being, I was forced to ponder those elements. As a journalist, I couldn't ignore what I heard, some statements of which were glaring. In previous books, as Elizabeth's angel, confidant, friend, or fan, I regret ignoring those statements. Had I found the courage to reveal them, this story may have had a different ending. I also sensed that if I had not elected to write an honest biography about Elizabeth, eventually someone else might do so, and not as delicately as I believe this material is presented here. In either case, it was clear to me that Elizabeth was multi-talented, multifaceted, and multi-complex, reclusive and protective, generous to a fault but private. She was anything but easy to figure out, certainly more challenging to analyze than any of her performances, and she delivered diverse interpretations of a myriad of characters with what appeared to be total ease. One of her more offbeat roles was that of private detective Sarah Scott in the 1983 CBS TV movie Missing Pieces, a mystery story that was adapted from Carl Alexander's novel A Private Investigation. In a similar way, this book detects and connects the missing pieces of a clandestine and extraordinary existence as it expounds on the amazing journey of a public figure who employed her widespread image for a better world. It's for the multitudes who remain charmed by the contrasting work of an actress before, during, and after her superstar-making twitch as a witch named Samantha, a beloved character who retained a fiercely independent spirit amidst other unique roles that were brought to life by a majestic, courageous, and real-life hero named Elizabeth Montgomery. At its core, Twitch Upon a Star, The Bewitched Life and Career of Elizabeth Montgomery, is about a celebrated individual who, for the sake of clarity, simplicity, and intimacy, and in tribute to her unaffected demeanor, will from here on in be mostly referred to as either Elizabeth or Lizzie, both which she so modestly and endearingly insisted on being known as at different times throughout her life and career.
Part 1. Prewitched. I just never had the desire to be a star. Elizabeth Montgomery. Look Magazine. January 26, 1965. 1. Once upon a time. I like to grow naturally instead of being pruned into formality. Elizabeth Montgomery. TV Radio Mirror Magazine. November 1969. Elizabeth Montgomery literally grew up on television, making her small screen debut on December 3rd, 1951, in Top Secret, an episode of her father's heralded anthology series, Robert Montgomery Presents, which aired on NBC between 1950 and 1957. She'd appear in a total of 28 episodes, but it was in secret that she played none other than the apple of her father's eye. Written by Thomas W. Phillips and directed by Norman Felton, this episode also featured Margaret Phillips as Maria Dorn, James Van Dyke, Edmund Jerry, John D. Seymour, Dawson, and Patrick O'Neill, Brooks. Foreign Service Agent Mr. Ward, Robert Montgomery, brings his daughter, Susan, Lizzie, on a mission to a country on the brink of revolution, with spies on all sides complicating the matter at hand. The secret title may have represented Elizabeth's off-screen desire for privacy, while other presents headings also proved significant, such as Once Upon a Time, written by Theodore and Matilda Farrow, airing May 31st, 1954. This time, Elizabeth played a newlywed who contemplates how different life might have been had she married someone else. In real life, Lizzie didn't just contemplate that notion. She lived it. Four times. With Fred Kamen, Gig Young, Bill Asher, and Robert Foxworth. 10 years after the Time episode of Presents aired, Bewitched debuted with the Saul Sachs pilot, I, Darren, Take This Witch, Samantha, narrated by Jose Ferrer. The show opened with his first line, Once Upon a Time. Whether represented on Robert Montgomery Presents or recited on Bewitched, it was a fairy tale phrase that Lizzie adored and which ignited her interest in both projects, especially Bewitched. As she recalled, in 1989, Bill Asher was in the room when she first read that term in the initial Samantha script. Okay, I love it, she said. That's it? Bill wondered. Once upon a time. And you love it? Yeah, she mused. Anything that starts out that way can't be all that bad. It was a spontaneous decision that intrinsically represented the essence of her carefree spirit, which in turn contributed in no small measure to the show's enormous success. In fact, before Jose Ferrer got the job, she had asked her father if he would narrate the Bewitched pilot. In 1991, she celebrated the 50th anniversary of his 1941 classic film, Here Comes Mr. Jordan, by granting an interview to Ronald Haver for a special Laserdisc release of the movie. It was here she revealed her father's decline to speak life into Bewitched, calling his response, very strange. No, I don't think so. Why not? It's your show. Ah, okay. All right. Elizabeth was disappointed, and she later told him so. She would have enjoyed him kicking off Bewitched, her new series in 1964, just as he had given a jumpstart to her TV career when she made her small screen debut on Robert Montgomery Presents in 1951. For Lizzie, success was at times a burden, especially when it came to public revelations. For one, her age was a sensitive issue, cloaked in a chicane. But as author and genealogist James Pilant explains, celebrity genealogies are always hard to trace. In 2004, Pilant authored The Bewitching Family Tree of Elizabeth Montgomery for genealogymagazine.com. Biographical data abounds, he said, yet there's no guarantee of accuracy. Elizabeth played into such wriggle room. Various studio and network press bios document her birth year at 1936 and 1938. In reality, it was 1933, as recorded in the state of California, California Birth Index, 1905 to 1995, published in Sacramento by the State of California Department of Public Health, Center for Health Statistics. When she died in 1995, a few obituaries listed her age as 57, trimming 5 years off her birth date. Others offered conflicting details about her marital status. Some said she was single at the time of her demise. Some said she was survived by her fourth husband, Robert Foxworth. But the marital mystery, as Pilant put it, was orchestrated by the self-protective Lizzie, who kept a step ahead of the press. She viewed a relationship with Foxworth as confidential. Even their marriage in 1993 was shrouded from the media. The event took place at the Los Angeles apartment of her manager, Barry Crossed, and not a soul knew about it until after the fact. Nevertheless, she appears on the Social Security Death Index as Elizabeth Asher, the surname of her third ex-husband, Bewitched producer-director William Asher. There, at least, her birth date is correct, April 15, 1933, although Elizabeth A. Montgomery is the name listed on her death certificate. The A is either for Asher or Allen, the maiden name of her mother, actress Elizabeth Allen. According to A&E's biography, Elizabeth Montgomery, A Touch of Magic, which originally aired on February 15, 1999. Lizzie's middle name was Victoria, a moniker sometimes linked with royalty, as is the name Elizabeth itself. But that fits. From the mid-1970s until her demise in 1995, she was known as Queen of the TV Movies. On Bewitched, Samantha was crowned Queen of the Witches in the episode Long Live the Queen, September 7th, 1967. Before that, Aunt Clara's, Marion Lorne, bumbling magic mishaps forced Sam's introduction to Queen Victoria, Jane Connell, in Aunt Clara's Queen Victoria Victory, March 9th, 1967. Before Lizzie basked in the sparkle of stardom as Samantha, she was born in the shadow of Robert Montgomery's fame. The story of who she was begins with him. The seeds of who she became were indelibly planted by this versatile actor and political idealist. A father who was just as complex as his daughter. A daughter who had a father complex. 5 years after his marriage to Broadway actress Elizabeth Allen on April 24, 1928, Lizzie was born into her privileged childhood at the peak of his film popularity. Talented, handsome, athletic, rich, and famous, Robert had the right social credentials, coupled with a solid intellect. Before his stable career on the small screen of the 1950s, he was a feature film legend of the 1930s and 1940s. Although he was a Republican and she a Democrat, Lizzie followed in his social advocacy. It was difficult for her to fathom and accept the scope of his notoriety before she ever began to question her own. She would later ponder the harvested influence over a legion of Bewitched buffs, because she had seen the role celebrity played in her father's life. Once she glittered with fame, it was hard for her to embrace praise, even from those whose lives she helped improve. A political promoter rooted with a conservative outlook, her father held a stoic position in moderate contrast to her liberal stance. But both believed in the American dream and the freedom that goes along with it. In 1935, he was elected to the first of four terms as president of SAG, the Screen Actors Guild. It was here his political agenda began to take shape. In this capacity, he gained publicity in 1939 when he helped expose labor racketeering in the film industry. He went on to become a lieutenant in the U.S. Navy Reserve, an assistant naval attaché at the American Embassy in London, an attendant at a naval operations room in the White House, a commander over a PT boat in the Pacific, and an operations officer during the D-Day invasion of France. He was awarded the Bronze Star and later decorated as Chevalier of the French Legion of Honor. In 1947, he headed the Hollywood Republican Committee to elect Thomas E. Dewey as president. That same year, he testified as a friendly witness in the first round of the House Un-American Activities Committee, denouncing communist infiltration in Hollywood. Following President Eisenhower's 1952 campaign, he was called on by the principal head of state to serve as a special staff consultant to television and public communications, the first individual to hold such a media post for the White House. Robert came to Eisenhower's attention because of his affiliation with Robert Montgomery Presents. During the 1960s, he was engaged in a futile campaign against the practices of commercial TV, which he summarized in the book An Open Letter from a Television Viewer, J.H. Heineman, 1968. Also in the 1960s, the decade in which his daughter would begin to turn the world on with her twitch, Robert served as a communications consultant to John D. Rockefeller III and a director of R.H. Macy, the Milwaukee Telephone Company, and the Lincoln Center for the Performing Arts. From 1969 to 1970, he was president of Lincoln Center's Repertory Theater. Stephen J. Ross is the author of Hollywood Left and Right, How Movie Stars Shaped American Politics, Oxford University Press, 2011. On April 22, 2012, Ross appeared on C-SPAN at the Los Angeles Festival of Books. When asked what role Robert Montgomery played in the Hollywood political game, he replied. Robert Montgomery actually had gone to prep school with George Murphy, and the two of them were very close friends. And Murphy, during the late 40s and 50s, was a very prominent Republican activist. In fact, he was Louis B. Mayer's, MGM executive, point man, going around the country. And when in 1952 Eisenhower wanted some help from Hollywood, or should I say the GOP got Eisenhower help, the two people who advised him on media strategy were Montgomery and Murphy. And Eisenhower liked the two of them so much that he basically told his Madison Avenue firm that had been hired to do the TV, "You can keep writing the ads, but they're going to show me how to appear on TV." Afterwards, Eisenhower asked both men to come to Washington with him. Murphy kindly deferred, and Montgomery still kept his career, but he actually had an office in Washington to help Eisenhower for 8 years, with sort of media appearance, and helping him stage his presence. Remember, this is a period when TV is just really emerging as a national phenomenon, and politicians don't really know how to deal with television. They were teaching them things like how to use makeup, what color glasses to use, how to face a camera, how to do sound bites, how to hold your body, camera angles. Everything that a sophisticated actor would learn, they taught to Eisenhower. As recorded in James Pilant's expertly researched Bewitching article, Robert Montgomery was born Henry Montgomery, Jr. on May 21, 1904, in Dutchess County, New York. Beacon is commonly given as his birthplace, though he was actually born in Fishkill Landing. Beacon was formed from the adjoining towns of Fishkill Landing and Matewan in 1913. Metro-Goldwyn-Mayer, MGM, promoted Robert Montgomery's movie persona as a sophisticated, well-bred socialite by embellishing the elite family background of its handsome star. And while the actor was born in a large house on the banks of the Hudson River, and his father served as an executive of a rubber company, the 1920 federal census leaves a somewhat different impression. 52-year-old Henry Montgomery, the vice president of a rubber factory, and Mary W., age 47, with sons Henry Jr., age 16, and Donald, age 14, all New Yorkers by birth, boarded in a Beacon hotel kept by William Gordon. Henry Sr. was a first-generation American, his father being Irish and his mother was Scottish. Mary W.'s father was a Pennsylvanian, while her mother was from the West Indies. 20 years earlier, the 1900 federal census shows the newly wedded Montgomerys, years married zero, boarded in William Gordon's hotel, then in Fishkill. Private Secretary Henry Montgomery Sr., age 32, born in May of 1868, and May W., age 24, born in March of 1867, were among the hotel's many boarders. Mrs. Montgomery's birthplace is listed as New Jersey, and her mother's birthplace is Jamaica. Robert Montgomery's mother is named in biographies of her son as Mary Weed Bernard, but her maiden name was actually Barney. At the time of the 1900 federal census, the Montgomerys had been married a little over 6 months, their marriage date being December 14, 1899. Mrs. Montgomery appears twice on the federal census in 1900, the second instance being as May W. Barney, age 25, born in March of 1875 in New Jersey. Her marital status was indicated as single, then written over to read married. She is named as a daughter of 81-year-old Nathan Barney, who rented a Third Street home in Brooklyn, wife Mary A., age 56, born in October 1843, sons George D., age 34, born in October 1865 in Connecticut, Nathan C., age 27, born in June 1873 in New Jersey, and Walter S., age 18, born October 1882 in New Jersey. A 23-year-old Irish servant also made her home with the family. Mr. Barney was born in Pennsylvania, and Mrs. Barney was born in Jamaica, West Indies, a fact consistent with what May W. Montgomery supplied in 1900. According to Genealogy of the Barney Family in America, Mary Weed Barney was born on March 30, 1875 in Bayonne, Hudson County, New Jersey, to Nathan Barney Jr. and his second wife, the former Mary A. Deverell. The Barney genealogy identifies the parents of Henry Montgomery Sr. as Archibald Montgomery and the former Margaret Edmonston of Brooklyn. Henry Montgomery, a one-year-old, is found in the household of Irish-born Archibald Montgomery, a prosperous shipping merchant, and Margaret, born in Scotland, on the rolls of the 1870 federal census in Brooklyn. In 1970, Robert Montgomery gave an interview to Richard Lemparski for his book, Whatever Became Of, Volume 3, Ace Books, 1970. He explained how he had to support himself after his father, an executive with a rubber company, died and left the family without an income. As Lizzie expressed to Ronald Haver in 1991, Daddy had to quit school and go to work to help support the family, and his father just kind of fell apart. That's putting it lightly. According to Pilant, Henry Sr. was depressed, suffered a nervous breakdown, and subsequently committed suicide. Not only did Robert Montgomery have to cope with the tragedy of his father's death, he had to face a financial crisis as well as the social stigma of having a suicide in the family. Henry Montgomery's nervous breakdown was also a public reminder of the scandal that unfolded in newspapers a generation earlier, when Archibald Montgomery, Robert's grandfather, was accused of being an insane alcoholic. The charges against Robert's grandfather were dismissed, yet the damage had been done to the family name. Whispers of a nervous breakdown, insanity, alcoholism, and suicide were devastating to a prominent family's social standing. Wire reports of Henry Montgomery's suicide caused the story to be spread in newspapers across the country. On October 25th and 28th, 1884, respectively, the Brooklyn Eagle published the articles, Is He Insane? The Predicament of a Well-Known South Brooklyn Man, and The Montgomery Suit, Withdrawal of the Suit at the Insistence of the Family, both about Archibald. On June 25, 1922, the Philadelphia Inquirer published this item titled, Man Jumps to Death from Brooklyn Bridge. Hundreds See Suicide from Trolley to Rail. A man believed to be Henry Montgomery of Brooklyn leaped to his death from the Brooklyn Bridge this evening in the view of hundreds of pedestrians and surface car and elevated train passengers. He leaped from a passing car to the bridge roadway, stepped to the rail without looking back, and jumped. On June 26, 1922, the Denver Post published the following item under the heading, Wealthy New York Rubber Firm Head Drowns Himself in River. Henry Montgomery, 45 years old of Brooklyn, wealthy retired president of the New York Rubber Company, committed suicide late Sunday afternoon by jumping into the East River. Montgomery, who had been suffering from a nervous breakdown which forced his retirement 10 months before, had apparently planned to take his own life and left instructions for notifying his relatives. Either way, Henry Sr. left his family penniless, and his son Robert, Henry Jr., was forced to pick up the slack as a railroad mechanic and oil tanker deckhand, and he was none too pleased about it. Fortunately, by the late 1920s and following ineffectual attempts to become a writer, he became an established Broadway actor, joining his stage peers in the mass migration into film as talkies came into play. But his subsequent tumultuous relationship with Lizzie may have been ignited by the resentment and the frustration he experienced in his pre-acting days. No doubt those years helped to foster a strong work ethic that he would later instill in Lizzie. But initially, it was no pleasant experience. What's more, a future family tragedy would further loosen and then only entangle the father-daughter link between Elizabeth and Robert Montgomery. Elizabeth and her father did not always see eye to eye, and they were definitely on opposite ends of the political spectrum. But their lives were in many ways similar. He was educated at exclusive private schools, as she would be later, at his instruction. She made her theatrical stage debut at 6 years old in Red Riding Hood's World, a French-language stage production at the aristocratic Westlake School for Girls in Los Angeles. His theatrical film premiere occurred much later in life, with the comedy Three Live Ghosts in 1929. But they both loved acting, after his initial objection to her vocational choice. Contracted with MGM, Robert would later be pigeonholed as that carefree leading man, just as Lizzie would later be typecast as a light-hearted leading witch, and just as she would later distance herself from Samantha. With a list of edgy TV and motion picture roles, Robert tried to break the happy-go-lucky mold and waxed psychotic in several feature films, including The Big House, a prison movie released in 1930 that set the pattern for similar future films, and Night Must Fall, a 1937 thriller in which he played a mysterious, brutal killer who terrorized the countryside. The latter earned him an Academy Award nomination. He received a second Oscar nod in 1941 for Here Comes Mr. Jordan, this time portraying an angel. On a flight to his next fight, boxer Joe Pendleton's, Robert, soul is prematurely snatched from his body by the newly deemed Heavenly Messenger 7013, Edward Everett Horton, when his plane crashes. Before the matter can be rectified by 7013's supervisor, the celestial Mr. Jordan, Claude Rains, Joe's body is cremated. So Jordan grants him the use of the body of wealthy Bruce Farnsworth, original character unseen, who's just been murdered by his wife, Rita Johnson. As Joe attempts to remake Farnsworth's unworthy life in his own clean-cut image, he falls for Betty Logan, Evelyn Keyes. Lizzie failed to win an Emmy for playing a witch on Bewitched, for which she was nominated 5 times, with a total of 9 nominations throughout her career. Her father failed to ace any formal acting award for playing a seraph or a psycho. In 1945, legendary film director John Ford became ill on the set of They Were Expendable, and Robert stepped in as his replacement, making his first mark as a director. After receiving this initial tech credit, he turned out an unusual, controversial production titled Lady in the Lake, 1947, a Raymond Chandler mystery thriller told in the first person through tricky subjective camera angles, much like Lizzie's Missing Pieces 1982 TV movie. Playing the hero, Private Eye Philip Marlowe, he was seen on the screen only 2 times, once in the prologue, then within the body of the film when he briefly crossed in front of a mirror. All other scenes were shown from his point of view, as if seen through his eyes. Robert went on to direct and star in several other films that received varied response before retiring from the big screen, and turned his attention to politics, TV, and the stage. On Broadway in 1955, he won a Tony Award for Best Director for the play The Desperate Hours. He later formed Cagney Montgomery Productions, with early screen idol James Cagney, to produce The Gallant Hours, 1960, his final effort as a film director. Cagney was fond of Lizzie, and later became a mentor of sorts, maybe something even closer. As she told Ronald Haver for the 1991 Laserdisc release of Here Comes Mr. Jordan, Cagney was one of her dad's closest friends, who was like a second father to her, and it never occurred to her that Cagney was a big star. Another larger-than-life celebrity who both Elizabeth and Robert Montgomery befriended was film legend Betty Davis. Lizzie would later take the lead in the 1979 TV movie Dark Victory, a remake of Davis's 1939 motion picture. Betty had co-starred with Robert in 1948's June Bride, directed by Brittain Windust. In time, Lizzie and Bette became closer friends than Bette and Robert, and he became jealous. Not so much of Betty, but of Lizzie. But as Betty recalled to author Charlotte Chandler in Betty Davis, a personal biography, The Girl Who Walked Home Alone, Simon & Schuster, 2006, Robert left little to be desired or envied. She even went as far as to describe him as a male Miriam Hopkins, a reference to her arch-rival on the big screen. Actress Hopkins had well-publicized arguments with Davis, who reportedly had an affair with Hopkins's then-husband, Anatole Litvak, when they co-starred in the films The Old Maid, 1939, and Old Acquaintance, 1943. Davis admitted to very much enjoying a scene in the latter movie, in which her character forcefully shapes Hopkins's character. There were even press photos taken with both divas in boxing rings with gloves up, and old acquaintances director, Vincent Sherman, standing between the two. Davis never came to such blows with Robert Montgomery on the set of June Bride, but she came close. She explained in Chandler's book, "He was an excellent actor, but addicted to scene stealing. He would add business in his close-ups which didn't match mine, so that there would only be one way to cut the film, his way." Mr. Montgomery understood films. Director Windust, who was not a film man at all, never noticed, and I couldn't have cared less. Montgomery was welcome to all the close-ups he wanted. I act with my whole body. In 1991, Elizabeth told Ronald Haver that her father and Davis didn't get along. After Lizzie had moved out of the Montgomery homestead, Robert would call and invite her to dinner. "I can't," she'd reply. "I'm going over to Betty's." "No," he'd say, and hang up. After meeting at various social events in New York, Davis became somewhat of a mentor for the young ingenue. In fact, while in her late teens, Lizzie was invited by Davis to her home in Maine, on a street named, appropriately enough, Elizabeth said, "Which Way?" That name represented Davis's reputation, and not Bewitched, which was years from creation. But for the moment, the witch reference seemed to fit Davis. And as Lizzie told Haver, she knew that. One weekend on Which Way, Lizzie and Betty picked beans from Davis's garden and later strung them inside the house while sitting in front of her fireplace. Shortly after, an argument ensued between the two. Davis stalked out of the room and then stopped in her tracks. She turned to face Lizzie and said, "Betty, when they do the story of my life, you should play me, and I'm not sure that's a compliment." Lizzie thought that was funny. Betty Davis was the only person Elizabeth Montgomery ever allowed to call her Betty. According to James Pilant's Bewitching Family Tree, Elizabeth Montgomery's death certificate gives her mother's maiden name as Elizabeth Allen, a Kentucky native. The 1930 federal census of Los Angeles County, California, shows Robert Montgomery, age 25, born in New York, actor, motion pictures, and wife Elizabeth A., also 25, born in Kentucky, and a 55-year-old servant, lived on Blackwood Drive in Los Angeles. The age at first married, for both, was 23. The couple had married on April 14, 1928, in New York, and the following year they moved to Hollywood when Robert signed a contract with MGM. Elizabeth was the couple's second child. Tragically, their firstborn, Martha Bryan Montgomery, died at age 14 months in 1931. In May 1965, Movie TV Secrets magazine published the article, "Witches Are People Too," by Jackie Thomas. It explained how Robert was devastated by the loss, how Tiny Martha's death left him in a state of severe depression that immobilized him for months. A friend who knew the Montgomerys described his condition. "I don't think I've ever seen anyone as shaken as Bob. All his life seemed to be invested in that child. When she died, something in him died with her. I don't think he has ever really recovered. Something inside him was twisted and destroyed by Martha's death." Lizzie was interviewed for that same article. She addressed her father's strict reign over her youth, one that seemingly increased with time, as if in gradual reaction and retaliation to her little sister's death, a young sibling she never knew. Little by little, her father's stern role nibbled away at her self-esteem until the day she died in 1995. But 30 years before, in May 1965, it was a different story. She said she was too sure of a great many things. Being the daughter of a star had its effect on her. Not that her father went out of his way to make things easier for her, because he didn't. In fact, she said, at times he bent over backwards to go in the opposite direction. Maybe that was his problem, she thought. He gave me the best of everything. Clothes, education, things like that. but he demanded a lot, too. Dad is a very complex man. I don't think I've ever been able to come up to Martha in his eyes. However, 5 months prior to that, she told TV Radio Mirror, I never replaced Martha in his heart, but I did help to soothe his grief. As was explained in Richard Lamparsky's book, Whatever Became Of, Volume 3, between 1928 and 1950, Robert Montgomery was married to actress Elizabeth Allen, with an A, an actress best known for her 1936 pairing with Ronald Colman in the 1935 film A Tale of Two Cities. But this Elizabeth Allen, born British in Skegness, England in 1908, was not Lizzie's mother, nor was she ever married to Robert. A little over two decades later, the American actress Elizabeth Allen, with an E, was born Elizabeth Ellen Gillies on January 25, 1929, in Jersey City, New Jersey. In 1972, she co-starred on ABC's The Paul Lynde Show, playing Lynde's on-screen wife in this series that was executive produced by Bewitched's Harry Ackerman and William Asher and Elizabeth Montgomery under their banner production company, Ashmont Productions. But this Elizabeth Allen was not Lizzie's mother either, nor was she ever married or related to Robert Montgomery. However, a second American actress named Elizabeth Allen, with an E, arrived on the scene before Gillies. James Pilant provides the details in his Bewitching article. Elizabeth Daniel Allen was born on December 26, 1904, in Louisville, Jefferson County, Kentucky, to Bryant Hunt Allen and the former Rebecca Lowry Daniel. Elizabeth Montgomery's maternal grandparents, like her paternal grandparents, were newlyweds at the time of the 1900 federal census enumeration. 57-year-old widow Ellen W. Daniel, born in Indiana in February of 1843, owned a house on Brook Street in Louisville, Kentucky, which she shared with daughter Lizzie W., age 25, son William A., age 35, daughter-in-law Molly, age 36, and daughter Rebecca Allen, age 20. Except for Ellen Daniel, all were born in Kentucky. Rebecca Allen's marital status is given as married, with zero given for the number of years married. Brian H. Allen is listed elsewhere in Louisville, although his marital status is recorded as single. An inspector for a gas company, he was born in November of 1877 in Kentucky to a Missouri father and a Kentucky mother. Rebecca Lowry Daniel Allen, Elizabeth Montgomery's beloved Becca, was born in June of 1879 in Kentucky, as per the 1900 census. But her death certificate gives June 5, 1886 as her birth date. Her death certificate also identifies her mother's maiden name as Wright. Daniel family genealogists show that Ellen Wright was the wife of Coleman Spencer Daniel, who died in Louisville on June 8, 1898, 2 years before Mrs. Ellen W. Daniel is shown on the rolls of the 12th federal census as a widow. Daniel family records show Ellen Wright Daniel died 2 years later, on June 7, 1902. The same record gives February 16, 1843, as her birth date, which agrees with what is found on the 1900 census. Coleman S. Daniel and Ellen Wright wedded in the bride's native Switzerland County, Indiana, on May 20, 1864. The daughter of John W. Wright, who represented Switzerland County in the state legislature, Ellen Wright was only 6 months old when her mother, Ellen Lowry Wright, died at age 36. Her father remarried the following year to Rebecca D. Saunders. Clearly, when Ellen Wright Daniel named her daughter Rebecca Lowry Daniel, she did so in honor of her mother and stepmother. It was Lizzie's grandmother, Becca, with whom she formed a special bond, and who eventually introduced her to the potentially lighter side of life, like horse racing and gambling. Becca moved with her daughters Elizabeth Allen and Martha Bryan to New York City in the early 1920s, where Martha Bryan had a role in the Broadway play He Who Gets Slapped, which played at the Garrick Theater. In all, Martha Bryan, mother to Lizzie's first cousin Amanda, a.k.a. Panda, a childhood playmate. Was in 24 plays at one point before she met her husband-to-be, Arthur Cushman. Into this mix, Elizabeth Allen also performed in several live stage productions until she married Robert Montgomery on April 14, 1928. She received superb reviews for many of these plays, such as with Revolt, of which the New York Times said, "The lovely Miss Allen is poised for leading lady status anytime soon. She always brings freshness to her roles." Allen and Robert were married at the Episcopal Church of the Transfiguration, also known as the Little Church Around the Corner, on 29th Street between 5th Avenue and Madison Avenue. The church was also the home of the Episcopal Actors Guild, of which she and Robert were members. She retired almost immediately at Robert's request for her to concentrate only on being his wife. Lizzie chatted about Elizabeth Allen to Modern Screen in May 1965. "Mother is a marvelous person. Just great. It's her attitude toward people that's so marvelous. She's a very warm, outgoing, generous human being. She'd acted on Broadway. That's where she met Dad. So did her sister, Martha Bryan Allen. Both of them got reviews that are so extraordinarily good. They make you sort of proud. Mother did light comedy. She starred with Lee Tracy and Elizabeth Patterson. But she gave up her career when she married Dad. And I don't believe ever regretted it for a moment. She loves her house, and she and Dad gave my brother and me a wonderful childhood. It just couldn't have been happier, healthier, or more fun." When Lizzie was a stage-struck teen, Robert tried to sway her decision from acting by using his wife as a prime example. According to the August 1967 edition of Screen Stars magazine, Robert told Lizzie that her mother was wise to forfeit her career to marry him and raise a family. He went on to tout his wife as the toast of Broadway, but that she knew her career would be detrimental to raising children. "It's difficult to know who your real friends are," Robert added. "Worst of all, acting requires the constant rejection of your real self. Sometimes you don't even know who you are anymore. Imagine what that does to a family." Lizzie wouldn't have to wonder about the consequences. She'd experience them firsthand. 2. Grimm. There's a little bit of a displaced person in everybody, and it's nothing to be ashamed of. Elizabeth to Ronald Haver, 1991. Elizabeth's young life was divided between her parents' massive estate in Paterson, New York, and their elegant home in Beverly Hills. It was there they hosted various dinner parties and Sunday brunches that were attended by the conservative likes of James Cagney, Betty Davis, Rosalind Russell, Irene Dunne, Frank Morgan, and George Arliss. Her parents moved in A-list circles and were considered Hollywood royalty. They were well-groomed, poised, and intelligent leaders of the community. They were quiet, private, and peaceful in their everyday lives. And like many of their friends, and later Lizzie, rejected exhibitionism and screwball conduct. On October 13, 1930, Robert Montgomery and Elizabeth Allen gave birth to the little girl they named after Allen's sister, Martha Bryan. The infant child, whose subsequent tragic death in December 1931, at only 14 months, due to spinal meningitis, would forever change the Montgomery family dynamic. Elizabeth's parents resided in a small house in Los Angeles until 1932, when they moved to Beverly Hills. Approximately 1 year later, little Lizzie arrived at 4:30 a.m. on April 15, 1933. And not 1936 or 1938. However, after her brother Skip was born on February 15, 1936, the family moved to Holmby Hills, an affluent neighborhood in West Los Angeles, just north of Sunset and east of Beverly Glen, in a custom-built 16-room mansion with an Olympic-sized swimming pool. They lived there until they all moved to New York. Franco Tone, a substantial star in Robert Montgomery's league at the time, then purchased the Beverly Hills home. Elizabeth later attempted to buy it back when she married Bill Asher, but Tone wouldn't budge. Subsequently, the Ashers purchased their Beverly Hills estate on Laurel Canyon Drive from Howard Hawks, the legendary director of Westerns along the lines of John Ford, where Lizzie remained after her divorce from Bill through her marriage to Bob Foxworth, and until her demise. Elizabeth told Ronald Haver in 1991 that her childhood was all very kind of abnormally normal. As Foxworth explained on A&E's Biography in 1999, the upscale world that she grew up in did not contribute to a regular childhood. She was expected to dress properly and to have good manners and behave in a certain way. She took that as an act, Foxworth believed, because it failed to mirror her own true feelings. So in a sense, he said, she was always an actress. In March of 1939, Robert Montgomery told Collier's Magazine that his farm in the Towners section of Paterson, New York, near Brewster, was his refuge from acting. He lived there 3 months a year, and any visitor to the farm who mentioned the entertainment industry in any way was reportedly apt to be slugged. Robert Montgomery's love-hate partnership with Hollywood would mirror his personal relationship with Lizzie. She didn't get along with her father because, as Foxworth also surmised on A&E's Biography, to some extent her father was envious of Elizabeth's popularity. Billy Asher Jr., the first of Lizzie's three children with William Asher, blamed the ongoing rift between his mother and grandfather on their opposing political views. He too appeared on Biography and said, they just didn't see eye to eye. In later years, she and her dad seldom spoke. But if she phoned him, at least he'd answer, as he did when Hollywood called him abroad in May of 1939. It was then he traveled to England to make The Earl of Chicago, which would become Lizzie's favorite of his films. A Chicago gangster, Montgomery, learns he has inherited an earldom in England, and he travels to London in order to claim it. He does so even though he remains involved with mobsters back in the States. Ultimately, he transforms from a two-bit gangster and ends up living in an English castle with this wonderful old valet, Edmund Gwen, who proceeds to tutor him in the ways of being an earl. Unfortunately, his previous life continues to haunt him. He commits murder, is tried by a jury of his peers in Parliament, and ends up in prison. In the end, his valet brings his best clothes, knickers, silk stockings, and patent leather shoes, coat with lace collar, ultimately dressing him for his execution. In 1991, Elizabeth expressed to Ronald Haver just how impressed she was with this movie. It's just a gem. And it's not because he's in it. I could see anybody in it, as long as they were as good as he was in it. It is imaginative, it's beautifully directed, it's cleverly acted. Edmund Gwen is so fabulous. It builds to such a point where they had the courage to do what they did at the end, instead of somebody saying, you're kidding, you can't do that. How can you possibly end it this way? I was just flabbergasted the first time I saw this. You think Superman will swoop down and take this man away? But he doesn't. And by God, the guy walks out of the prison, down to the guillotine, starts to walk up the steps, and there's a wonderful cut of Edmund Gwen in the window, looking down, where the Earl of Chicago is totally panic-stricken at this point. The look on his face is just the most horrendous thing. I mean, he's just scared to death, and quite rightly, when he realizes that nothing is going to save him. And he turns around, and he looks as if he's about to be ready to run, and looks up at the window and sees the valet at the window. And the valet bows to him, and he realizes, oh God, it's just a killer. He realizes he's got to go through with this. Oh, I was in tears. I almost am now thinking about it. It was just extraordinary. Lizzie then elaborated on the scene during which the Earl was tried in front of Parliament, how her father decided not to see the set before filming, or that scene's dialogue. He knew his character was on trial. He had a vague concept of the questions and answers, but he had no idea about protocol. He just didn't want to make himself familiar with the script at all. And I think when you watch the movie, you can tell. Because when those doors open into that room, it's like he thinks, my God, this sure isn't like any little courtroom in Chicago that I've ever seen before. It's just this kind of awestruck, kind of almost childish thing that happens to this man. I love that movie. Can you tell? Although Elizabeth's adult relationship with her father was strained, she never stopped loving him. And he never stopped loving her or her brother Skip. Family-oriented, Robert, unlike the Earl of Chicago, refused to go to Britain unless his wife and children accompanied him. And they did. But while the Montgomerys journeyed to the United Kingdom, the Nazis invaded Norway, World War II began, and Robert promptly joined the American Field Service Ambulance Corps and was attached to the French Army as an ambulance driver. A young Lizzie and her even younger brother Skip were then shipped back to the United States on an Arundora Star steamship bound for New York City. Due to the radio silence of the time, it was 8 days before their parents learned of their safe arrival under the care of Lizzie's grandmother, Becca, who was there to greet and take them back to California. In 1991, Elizabeth offered a concise description of her father to Ronald Haver for the 50th anniversary Laserdisc release of Here Comes Mr. Jordan. Primarily self-educated, well, brilliantly, with a very kind of quirky sense of humor, very stubborn, arrogant, pompous to a point where I wanted to slap him sometimes, could be extremely understanding one minute and just irrational the next. I don't mean irrational. I mean to someone that disagreed with him, irrational, obviously. Very obviously right-wing politically. But he was terrific with little children, and they seemed to adore him, which is always a good sign, she laughed. And he loved animals. He adored my mother. He adored my stepmother. He was very hard on my brother, much more so on him than me. He loved pretty things, like antique stuff or modern even. He loved Andrew Wyeth, who was also a friend of his. He loved Dalmy, Max Beerbohm. I loved the way he dressed. There were times when he'd be kind of tweedy. Maybe that was his pompous wanting to be King of England department. I always remembered, too, when I was little, how handsome he looked in a dinner jacket. He always seemed very at home when he was dressed up a lot, very relaxed. So it just suited him very well, as did riding a horse. He had his own kind of style, and he had a great voice, really nice voice. He used to read Dickens's A Christmas Carol every Christmas, and I used to love that. It was wonderful. Robert Montgomery was clearly a larger-than-life figure in Lizzie's eyes, but she still referred to him as just plain Daddy, in much the same way that Samantha called to her warlock father named Maurice, played by the late Maurice Evans. In fact, before Evans was cast as Maurice, Lizzie asked Robert to play the role. Unfortunately, she recalled in 1989, he said no, but I would have loved him to do it. He would have been divine in the role. She couldn't help but feel despondent about the ordeal. She was already disappointed that Robert had declined to narrate the Bewitched pilot in 1964. Now he rejected the chance to play his daughter's father on screen, as she had played her father's daughter on that top-secret episode of Robert Montgomery Presents in 1951. Robert, however, had been ill when she asked him to portray Maurice, so he may not have been able to do the role, even had he so desired. And while Lizzie believed Evans was perfect for the part of her majestic TV father, that's how she also had described her real daddy. As a child, Elizabeth had not realized her father was a star. He just worked for a living, like everyone else's dad, so he just so happened to be an actor and worked at a movie studio. That didn't seem out of the ordinary. As she explained to Photoplay magazine in 1968, his work never entered their home, and she rarely saw him on the job. She visited one of his sets once, maybe twice, when she was growing up, but she didn't discover his occupation until someone told her at Westlake. As she lamented in 1992 to John Tesh on his short-lived TV show, One-on-One, it was kind of like finding out there was no Santa Claus. It never occurred to her that he was doing something odd or wonderful, or not so wonderful, with his career. However, in August 1967, Jacqueline Starr wrote in Screen Stars magazine, Robert Montgomery tried everything in his power to keep his daughter from confusing the Robert Montgomery, suave movie hero, with Daddy, the loving, gentle man who was, nevertheless, human and capable of error. But Liz saw only a bigger-than-life father, the one on the screen. And when he tried to tell her about all the everyday problems of being an actor, she just wouldn't listen. She was convinced that everything Daddy did was perfect, and she intended to follow suit herself. That's when she ran into genuine trouble. However wonderful or not so wonderful Robert Montgomery was, he could not prevent his legal detachment from Lizzie's mother, Elizabeth Allen. In turn, Lizzie, like other children of dysfunctional households from any era, was forced to become what was then referred to as a product of a broken home. Her parents divorced on December 5th, 1950, after Robert had an affair with yet another Elizabeth in the fray. This one, Elizabeth Buffy Grant Harkness, who was married to William Harkness, one of the wealthiest socialites in New York City. Buffy was also heiress to the Standard Oil fortune, and she married Robert on December 9th, 1950, a mere 4 days after his divorce from Elizabeth Allen. At the time, it was noted that not only did the second Mrs. Montgomery have the same first name as her predecessor, but she bore a striking resemblance to her as well. But according to the January...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.